Hello friends, welcome to Learner's Planet. Friends, in this session I am going to take the questions from CAT 2002 Quantitative Aptitude Paper. You must attend the basic sessions before you come for this session, right? And I hope you might have attended the previous sessions of previous year CAT papers. So in this session, let's take some more problems, and the problems will be from CAT 2002 Quantitative Aptitude, right? Let's see this question. The question is from permutation and combination. If there are 10 positive real numbers n1, n2, n3, these numbers are in ascending order. How many triplets of these numbers like n1, n2, n3, n2, n3, n4 can be generated such that in each triplet the first number is always less than the second number and the second number is always less than the third number, right? That means precisely we have 10 numbers which are in ascending order and we have to make the triplets and all the three numbers should be in ascending order. That means first number is less than second and second is less than the third, right? That means n1 is less than n2 and that's less than n3, right? Now it's very simple concept. First of all, we have to choose three numbers out of 10, right? So how many triplets we are able to make? That's 10C3, right? So from 10C3, we'll be getting the number of triplets like N1, N2, N3, N2, N3, N4 and so on, right? So these triplets, right? Now in every triplet, there will be three numbers, right? And these three numbers, in how many ways can we arrange them in ascending order? There is just single way, right? Getting me? Just single way. Suppose the three numbers selected are 2, 3 and maybe 7. So there is a single way to arrange these three numbers into ascending order when n1 is less than n2 and that's less than n3. That is 2, 3 and 7. Right? So whatever the numbers or whatever the triplets which are being selected, there is a single way of arranging them in ascending order, right? So how many triplets will be there? It's 10C3 only. No need to make any sort of arrangement. So what 10C3 is? It's 10 into 9 into 8 by 3 into 2, right? You have to go up to 3 steps down and then factorial of 3, right? So it's 3, 3, 2, 4, so it's 120, right? This is the question from CAT 2002. Such a simple question, just a very simple logic. Then when you are choosing the triplets, you don't have to arrange them since there is a single way of arranging the three numbers in ascending order. Okay, I hope you are clear. Now friends, let's see this problem. In triangle ABC, the internal bisector of angle A meets BC at D. If AB is equal to 4, AC is 3 and angle A is 60 degree, then the length of AD is. First of all, I just draw the diagram of this triangle. Now this is the triangle we are talking about. This is vertex A, B and C and this is D, right? Now AB is equal to 4, AC is equal to 3. Angle A is equal to 60 degree. This complete angle is 60 degree. Then the length of AD is, and D, the internal bisector of angle A meets BC at D. That means this is AD is internal angle bisector of angle BAD. Now if this complete angle is 60 degree, that means this is 30 and this is 30, right? Now we have to find out the value of AD. Suppose it is X, right? Now friends, there are various formula to calculate the area of a triangle or length of various sides, right? The most simplest is half base into altitude. Apart from that, we use sine formula to calculate the area of triangle. Now how sine formula is used, I just explain it over here. So it will be useful for your whenever you get the questions of based on calculation of area of triangle, right? Just listen to me carefully. Now suppose we have any triangle PQR, right? So this is angle P, this is angle Q, this is angle R, right? Maybe the lengths are maybe say A, B and C, right? So what is sine formula to calculate the area of the triangle is half product of the sides and included angle, right? So suppose we know this angle and these two sides. So in that case, area will be A into C into sine Q, right? That's sine Q. Or half C into B into sine R. Or half B into A into sine B. So precisely it is product of the sides into half into sine of included angle, right? So it's A into C sine Q, B into C sine R, A into B sine P and half of that, right? So this is how we can calculate the area of any triangle using sine formula. So the same funda I'm using over here. Now this is a complete triangle ABC, right? And this is made up of two triangles, that is ABD and ADC. That means the area of triangle ABC will be obtained by adding the area of triangle ABD and ADC, right? So I just write it over here. Area of triangle ABC is equal to area of triangle ABD plus area of triangle ADC, right? Now what? I just calculate the area of triangle ABC. What that will be? It's half 4 into 3 into sine of included angle. Now what is included angle? That is 60 degree. So it is sine 60 degree. And that should be equal to area of triangle ABD, that's half into 4 into x into sine 30 degree plus half into x into 3 into sine 30 degree. Just a moment. So half 3x sine 30 degree. Now this half can be taken as common and can be cancelled out. Now we just have to put up the value of sine 60, sine 30 and sine 30. And only x is the unknown quantity, that is nothing but the length of AD that we will be able to calculate. Now what is the value of sine 60, that 60 degree? That is root 3 by 2 that you might have studied in your grade 9 or 10. So it's 4 into 3, that is 12 into root 3 by 2 is equal to 4 sine 30 degree plus 3 sine 30 degree, this is 7 times x into sine 30 degree, and sine 30 degree is nothing but 1 by 2, right? So x is equal to what? 12 root 3 by 7. And this is what the length of AD, and we were asked about the length of AD, right? So we have option B as 12 root 3 by 7. So the problem becomes very simple if you know the sine formula, right? I hope you are clear. So the sine formula can be used anywhere whenever you have to find out the area of the triangle. And if one angle is given and the included sides are given, then you can use this formula. I hope you are clear. Now let's see this problem. The length of the common chord of two circles of radii 15 and 20 centimeters whose centers are 25 centimeters apart is, right? So we have to find out the length of the common chord. First of all, I just draw these two circles. Wait a moment. Now friends, this is a diagram with us. These are the two circles and this is common chord. This, I just name it over here. It's suppose O, this is P, this is Q, this is R, this is maybe X, right? So OP is radii of this circle, PQ is radii of this circle. So it's 15, this is 20 and centers are 25 centimeter apart. That means this complete length is, that is OQ is 25, right? Now we have to find out the value of common chord, that is we have to find out PR. Okay. Now, if you can observe 15, 20 and 25, if I divide the three numbers by 5, what I'll be getting? This 3, 4 and 5. And 3, 4 and 5 are Pythagorean triplet. If 3, 4, 5 are Pythagorean triplet, that means multiple of them will also be in Pythagorean triplets, right? That means 15, 20, 25 are also Pythagorean triplet. Now if these three are Pythagorean triplet, that means This triangle OPQ is nothing but a right angle triangle, right? So it is right angled at this. So the largest length, that is 25, will be hypotenuse. Okay, so 15, 20 and 25, this is the three lengths of a right angle triangle. Now we have to calculate PX, right? And if we double PX, it will be give us the value of PR, right? Now what, how do I calculate PX? What I do is, see, PX is nothing but perpendicular on OQ, right? Now, what will be the area of this triangle? That is OPQ, that is half of 15 into 20, right? That is, of any right angle triangle, the area is half perpendicular into base. Okay, in other ways we can write out as half base into altitude, right? So base is what, 25, and on this base altitude is PX, that we do not know, that we have to calculate. So I just take it as unknown quantity, right? So PX is equal to 15 into 20 by 25. So PX is 4 into 3, 12. That means the complete length PR is 24, right? So it's 24. Now you must be wondering why I just doubled that. Since it's a property of chord and radius, that if we drop a perpendicular from center on any chord, it bisects the chord and it is perpendicular over there, right? So, or in other words, if we drop a perpendicular, it will bisect the chord. So this angle is 90 degree, that means this length OX will bisect this chord. Okay, so this is how X is the midpoint of PR. So to get the complete value of PR, we just doubled PX. So that's 24 centimeter, right? So the problems becomes very simple. Okay, now let's see this problem. On a straight road XY 100 meter long, 5 heavy stones are placed 2 meter apart beginning at the end X. A worker starting at X has to transport all the stones to Y by carrying only one stone at a time. The minimum distance he has to travel is, suppose this is X, Y, and the complete length is 100 meter, right? This is what, 100 meter. Okay, now 5 heavy stones are placed beginning at X. So first stone is over here, then second, then third, then fourth, and then fifth, right? And 2 meter apart. So this length is 2, this is 2, this is 2, and this is 2. And this is the remaining length, that is 2, 4, 6, 8, and this is 92. Now it's just simple and addition problem, no much tensions are there. The first stone, the person has to pick from here and drop it over here. So the length has to be covered up, that is 100. Then for the second stone, he has to cover up the length of 98, right? But this length 98 he has to cover for 2 times because the person is moving from X to Y, so he's going 100. And while coming back, he is traveling 98. And after coming here, if he has to put up the stone at Y, further he has to go for 98 meters. So this is for 2 times, right? Similarly, when he comes back for the third stone, he has to cover up 96 for 2 times, right? So 1, 2, 3 stones are there. Then when he comes back for the fourth stone, he has to cover up 94 for 2 times, right? So he has reached there. Now he has to come back for the fifth stone. So it's 92 for 2 times, right? So this is the calculation. So it is 100 plus 2 into 98 plus 96 plus 94 plus 92. Now I don't have to tell you how to add the numbers and multiply them. 98 plus 92, that's 190, and plus 190, that is 380. So 2 into 380, that is 760, and plus 100 is 860 meters, right? So it's simple problem of addition, or maybe you can use arithmetic progression. Okay, I'm sure you are clear, and you must be having your paper and pen with you, so you are solving the problems with me simultaneously. Now let's try this question. In the figure given below, ABCD is a rectangle. The area of isosceles right angle triangle ABE. ABE, this is isosceles right angle triangle, that is area is 7, and EC is equal to 3BE. So suppose BE is X, EC is 3X. Now diagram is not to scale. So this is X and this is an isosceles right angle triangle. So if it is X, it will also be X, right? Now what we have to do? We have to find out the area of this rectangle, right? Now area of this triangle is 7 cm², right? So what is the area of this triangle ABE? That is half into X, and that is given to us as 7. So X square is 14, right? So that means X is equal to root 14. Okay. Now the area of this rectangle will be what? X into 4X. This length into this complete length. So it is X into 4X. That means it is 4X square. That means it is 4 into 14. That is 56. Right? A very simple from a question from CAT 2002. I hope you are clear. Now this problem from coordinate geometry, the area of triangle whose vertices are this. I just draw the coordinate axis over here. Just wait a moment. Now friends, the problem will be simpler if we assume some value of A, right? So let's assume a simple value of A. Maybe I just assume it to be 0. Okay. Now suppose it is 0, 0. So this is the first point. Then 0 plus 1, 0 plus 1. So this is the second point. And then A plus 2, that is 0 plus 2. This is 0, 0. This is 1, 1. And this is 2, 0. So 2, 0 will be somewhere here. So this is the triangle. Okay. So now since this length is 1 and this length is also 1, that means this length will be, this is the figure like this, this and this. So this is 1, this is 1, that means we can use Pythagoras theorem over here. So it will be root 2, right? So this length is root 2 and this length is also root 2, right? And this complete length is 2, that means it is a right angle triangle. So we can calculate the area easily, that is half of root 2 into root 2, that's half of 2, that's 1, right? So we are getting the value independent of A, right? We assume the value of A as 1, but we are getting a constant value, that is 1. That means whatever the value you put up of A, you'll be getting the same answer as 1, okay? I hope you are clear, and if you wish, you can assume any other value of A as well and calculate in the similar manner. Now this question, the owner of a local jewelry store hired 3 watchmen to guard his diamonds, but a thief still got in and stole some diamonds. On the way out, the thief met each watchman one at a time. To each he gave half of the diamonds he had stolen then and 2 more besides. He escaped with 1 diamond. How many did he steal originally? Friends, instead of making any sort of algebraic equations over here, what we do is we just go backward, right? And quickly eliminate the option. Be very fast over here. Suppose the correct answer is 40, right? So to the first watchman, he is giving half and then 2, right? So half of 20, half of 40 is 20, and the 2 beside that is, he is left with 18. And to the other one, he is giving further half and 2 apart from that, right? So the first step, I just write it over here. First to first watchman, he is giving 20 plus 2, so it's 22. Now he's left with 18. Then half of 18, that's 9. And then plus 2, so it's given 11. So after that, he is left with 7 diamonds. So to the third watchman, he cannot give half of them, right? So this is wrong option because we are having an odd number. Now we start with 36. So to the first watchman, he is giving 18 and plus 2, so it's 20. then he's left with 16. So half of 16, that is 8, then plus 2, then he's giving 10, then he's left with 6. So half of 6, that is 3, and then plus 2, he's giving 5. So he's left with 1, right? So 36 is the obviously correct choice, right? You don't have to calculate further. I hope you are clear. No need to make any sort of algebraic equation over here, right? Now, the problem based on ratio and proportion. Mayank, Mirza, Little and Jaspal bought a motorbike for $60. Mayank paid one half of the sum of the amounts paid by the other boys. Mirza paid one third of the sum of the amounts paid by the other boys. Little paid one fourth of the sum of the amounts paid by the other boys. How much did Jaspal have to pay? Now, friends, the problem is very simple. You can do it even mentally. Mayank is paying one half of the other. Sis, Mayank. And this is remaining, right? If remaining is paying X, Mayank is paying half of X, right? So if it is they are paying X, he's paying 2X, and this is Mayank is paying X, right? So the ratio of Mayank and others is 1:2. That means in all, Mayank is paying one third, right? This is X plus 2X, that is complete 3X, and Mayank is paying X, right? So it's one third of the total. So Mayank is paying 20, right? Similarly, the other person, Mirza, is paying one third of the sum by the other. So it's Mirza and remaining. So it is 3X and it is X. So in all, Mayank is Mirza is paying one fourth of 60. So that's 15. Similarly, the third guy, Little is paying one fourth of the sum. So it's Little and remaining. So if it is 4X, it is X. So in all, Little is paying 1 by 5th of the total. So 1 by 5th is 12, right? So this is Mayank, this is Mirza, this is Little. And jointly, they are paying 5 plus 2, 7, 2, 3, 4, 47. They are paying. So the remaining $13, this guy Jaspal is paying. Okay? No need to go for bigger calculation. It's very simple. Like I have just shown you over here, but you can calculate it mentally, right? Now we have an interesting question. Shyam visited Ram during his brief vacation. In the mornings, they both would go for yoga. In the evenings, they would play tennis. To have more fun, they indulge only in one activity per day. That is, either they went for yoga or played tennis each day. There were days when they were lazy and stayed home all day long. There were 24 mornings when they did nothing, 14 evenings when they stayed at home, and a total of 22 days when they did yoga or played tennis. For how many days Shyam stayed with Ram, right? Now, I assume that the number of days which we have to find out, that is Shyam stayed with Ram, is X days. Now, in X days, X mornings are there and X evenings are there, right? So, out of X mornings, these persons were 24 mornings when they did nothing. So total X mornings are there. So in 24 mornings they are doing nothing. That means in the remaining days they are playing, they are doing yoga, right? So X minus 24 mornings they are doing yoga. Similarly, there are total X evenings, and out of this X evenings, 14 evenings they are doing nothing. So remaining X minus 14 evenings they are playing tennis, right? So these days they are playing, they are doing yoga, and these days they are playing tennis. So in all it is 22 days. Okay, because they are indulging for any one activity per day. So this is for yoga or this is for this tennis. So it's 2x is equal to 24 plus 14 plus 22, that's 60. So x is equal to 30. Right? So the stay of Shyam was 30 days with Ram. Okay? Very simple problem, but interesting. Now friends, let's see this problem. Amol was asked to calculate the arithmetic mean of 10 positive integers, each of which had 2 digits. By mistake, he interchanged the 2 digits, say A and B, in one of these 10 integers. As a result, his answer for the arithmetic means was 1.8 more than what should have been. then b minus a equals. Before we proceed for this problem, I would just like to discuss over here a property of two-digit number and the numbers obtained by interchanging the digits of this particular two-digit number. Suppose we are having a two-digit number xy, right? So xy, if this is a two-digit number, it can be written as 10x plus y. And if I reverse the digit, it will be yx, and that is 10y plus x, right? So if I deduct this two-digit number from this, that is obtained by interchanging the digits, what I'll be getting, it's 10y plus x minus 10x plus y. So what I'll be getting, 9 times y minus x, right? So this is the difference of two-digit number and its interchange digits, right? So we can observe that if we deduct a two-digit number from the number which we are getting by interchanging a digit, it's always multiple of 9, right? We are able to see that it's 9 times y minus x. And if we divide this difference by 9, we will be getting the difference between the digits. That's right. That's y minus x. Okay. We can take practical examples of this as well. Suppose I am having maybe a number, say 35, right? And if I deduct 35 from 53, I'll be getting 18, right? And if I divide 18 by 9, I'll be getting 2. That's difference between the digits. Okay, so this is a two-digit number. This is a two-digit number which is obtained by reversing up the digit of this. And if we get the difference, it will be divisible by 9. And if we divide the difference by 9, we'll be getting the difference between the digits, right? So precisely over here, A and B are two digits. So this is the number, and by mistake, it has been written like this. Okay, now in mean, there's a difference of 1.8, right? So in total, the difference will be 1.8 into 10, because there are total 10 numbers. So the difference will be 18. Okay, that means AB by mistake has been written as BA, right? So the difference is 18. So if we divide 18 by 9, we'll be getting the difference between digits. And what is that difference? It's that B minus A. Okay, as simple as that. So it's 2. Okay, so this is the concept behind this problem, right? But you should be knowing it, because at the time of exam, if you do not know, then you cannot arrive at the correct answer. Okay, you can take other examples also. You can make some two digit numbers on your own, and you can very well verify this concept. I just take one more for you. It's maybe 81, and the reverse of this is 18. So difference between these two is 63. That is multiple of 9. And if you divide this by 9, you'll be getting the difference between the digits. Okay. So very simple yet important concept. I hope you are clear. Now we have this problem. When 2 raised to 256 is divided by 17, the remainder would be. Good number of sums I have already discussed based on this remainder theorem in my basic number system sessions. So I won't spend much time over here. We just quickly do it. 2 raised to 256. 256 is multiple of 4. So I can convert it is into 16 raised to something, right? So it's 2 raised to 4 into 64, right? That is 16 raised to 64. Now 16 can be written as 17 minus 1 raised to 64. So if we divide this expression by 17, we'll be getting the remainder as minus 1 raised to 64. So minus 1 raised to even power, that's 1 only. Okay. So precisely we are using binomial theorem over here, but I won't explain the entire concept over here. If you are not clear about this concept, do attend the basic number system sessions where I have explained a good number of problems based on remainder theorem. Okay. So it's just 1. So if you are clear about this concept, you can do this problem mentally even. It won't take your more than 20-25 seconds. Okay. Now let's see this question. Three travelers are sitting around a fire and are about to eat a meal. One of them has 5 small loaves of bread. The second has 3 small loaves of bread. And the third has no food but has 8 coins. He offers to pay for some bread. They agree to share the 8 loaves equally among the 3 travelers, and the third traveler will pay 8 coins for his share of the 8 loaves. All loaves were the same size. The second traveler, who had 3 loaves, suggests that he will be paid 3 coins and the first traveler be paid 5 coins. The first traveler says that he should get more than 5 coins. How much should the first traveler get? See, the problem looks like simple. It is actually simple, but you have to think over here. See, out of 8, the first one is having 5 breads and the other is having 3 breads, right? So this is maybe A and this is B. So he's having 5 and he's having 3. So according to B, it's okay that the ratio should be 5:3. But what is happening over here, that these 3 people, suppose this is C, they are sharing the breads equally, right? So C will be paying the amount to the person from which he is getting the bigger share, right? So see, there are 8 breads, the first person, and they are sharing it equally. So he is taking 8/3, he is also taking 8/3, he is also taking 8/3, right? So out of 5, he is taking 8/3. So what is he giving? That's 5 - 8/3, right? So he should be getting the amount for the bread he is giving to the third person, not what he is eating himself, right? In this case, he is having 3 and he's giving 8/3 to the third, 8/3 he is consuming himself. So he is giving 3 - 8/3, right? So this is what, 15 - 8/3, so it's 7/3, and it is 9 - 8/3, so it's 1/3. So precisely the ratio should be 7:1, right? So 7 rupees should go to A and 1 rupee should go to B. That will be the justified distribution of the amount, okay? Good number of people confused over there. They distribute them in the ratio of 5:3, but this is wrong, because they should get the return on the bread which they are giving to C, right? Not on starting whatever they are having in their hand, right? So 7:1 is the correct ratio. That means 8 rupees. So 7 rupees will go to A and 1 rupee will go to B, right? A simple yet conceptual problem. I hope you are clear. Our friends will be taking more such problems or in fact problems from previous year CAT papers in our next session. Do revise this session and the previous sessions as well. Bye-bye. I'll see you in the next session once again.